Just a quick update for you from the New York Post on actor Rick Moranis. He emerged in public today to grocery shop nearly a week after he was sucker punched during the random attack that we just shared with you. So it seems that he is doing all right.
Yeah, we should. I'm not one of these guys that likes to get in and change the name of everything, but sucker punch kind of makes it your fault. You know what I mean?
You're right. That is so victim blamey.
I know. Sucker rape victim.
Exactly.
Doesn't work, does it?
Does not work at all.
Right. The music sucker ethnic cleanser. All right. See, it doesn't work. He's not a sucker. He's walking down the street. He was felon punched.
There you go.
Next time Garagos is in, call it the sucker genocide.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah,
see how that goes.
He's not going to like if I replace Armenian with sucker. Yeah.
Sucker sex trafficker?
Doesn't work. Yeah, you're right.
Work.
Yeah, he was minding his own P's and Q's, and he was punched. But he's not the sucker. He's the victim.
Eddie Van Halen, as you must have already heard, died yesterday. Obviously, the music community was rocked by his death, and I wanted to share some tributes with you that poured in.
Get it? Rocked. Patty Smyth was, as Brian pointed out yesterday, asked by Eddie Van Halen to replace David Lee Roth with Van Halen after.
We'll have to ask her about that.
We'll have to talk to her about that, but yes, go ahead.
Yeah, I think she said that there was too much partying going on with the band. And at the time she was asked, she was very pregnant. And so it just didn't fit in with her lifestyle. That's what I read. But I'm very interested to talk about it with her. She would have been an amazing addition to that band, if you ask me. David Lee Roth tweeting, "What a long, great trip it's been." Valerie Bertinelli.
You know, high school yearbook quote?
Yeah, really.
And then he followed it up with "Have a great summer," which was soon.
KIT.
That's
right. Stay sweet. Mm-hmm. I'm so grateful. This is Valerie Bertinelli. I'm so grateful Wolfie and I were able to hold you in your last moments. I will see you in our next life, my love. Lynette Carolla.
Weren't they divorced a long time ago?
You know, she was at his bedside when he passed. They had been divorced a long time. His new wife, Janie, was there, and Valerie Bertinelli was also there.
Awkward.
Right. Mm-hmm.
Lynette Carolla, also a fan.
At his bedside?
She loves Van Halen.
She was also, that was so strange. She was also at his bedside. She posted, "The soundtrack of my youth. I hope his music inspires up-and-coming musicians and bands born out of backyards of suburbia. He was an iconic hero in our high school, a real L.A. Pasadena boy gone too soon." Now, some of you might not know that Gene Simmons had been an early booster of Van Halen. He even helped them record a demo before they got signed. He posted, "My heart is broken. Eddie was not only a guitar god, but a genuinely beautiful soul. Rest in peace, Eddie." Lenny Kravitz, "Heaven will be electric tonight."
I don't know. Are you guys bothered by those, you know, when they do that, here's what's going to be in heaven? There's a Righteous Brothers song. I'm looking at you, Kalen. There's a Righteous Brothers called Rock and Roll Heaven, and you guys have heard this song before. It's the Righteous Brothers version of Abraham, Martin, and John. It's like, if you know anybody here, see my old friend Martin, can you tell me where he's gone? It's a sing about Abraham Lincoln and John Kennedy, and this is the Righteous Brothers singing about a rock and roll heaven and all the dead rockers that are now up there putting on a show. It's kind of okay. It's a little corny. If you believe in forever, 1974. So I don't think Eddie Van Halen's on this list. If there's a rock and roll heaven, well, you know what? Ben!
Jimmy gave us rainbows.
Janice took a piece of our heart. Janice. And Otis. To the dock of the beach. See the way they do that? Sing a song to let Light My Fire. Oh, Jim Morrison. So they got a hell of a band.
I like that line.
Life is just a one-night stand. All right, little Righteous Brother trivia for you guys.
In stark contrast to that, do you want to hear a little Eruption recorded in New Haven, Connecticut, 1986, live?
Yeah. Yeah,
that is widely widely considered one of the greatest guitar solos of all time.
Yeah, well, speaking of old stories, I got an Eruption story.
Oh,
oh yeah, that was one of the clearest. You know, there's those sort of bad bottom out days you remember from your early life. Probably less as you get older, but for me, having a motorcycle towed and then having to like hitchhike home and all those things. Some of it was the byproduct of not having a cell phone, not having a credit card, not having cash, like not having anything and sort of getting screwed and stuff broke down and, you know, you had to walk or sleep by the side of the road or whatever. I got a few of those stories. This Eruption story is probably, It's bottom five. It's probably not bottom three, but bottom five is my Eruption story. I was living in my small first apartment with Donnie, or sleeping on the same futon, living on Laurel Canyon, and for some reason, one weekday, I wasn't working and he wasn't working, and we were just sitting at home. I was at the time making probably $8 an hour working as a carpenter, not really a carpenter, it was like a laborer. And missing work, I used to not be able to really enjoy it because my entire life, if I missed work, I didn't get paid for that day. Mm-hmm. So missing work is kind of like, well, you're living paycheck to paycheck and you've missed a day of work. You don't get paid. So enjoy yourself, but I don't know how much you can enjoy yourself. Now, if you're getting paid and you like stay home, you're like, good, I'm going to see a movie and I'm going to go out to eat. But the notion of spending money when you actually weren't getting paid that day kind of sucked. Anyway, I wasn't working. He wasn't working. And it was the middle of the day. And I realized that I had to go to Home Savings and Loan on Laurel Canyon and Ventura Boulevard and try to deposit something in my checking account because I knew our rent check was coming close to not to bouncing. And I went to Home Savings and Loan, and when I walked up, there was a guy with a van, and he was selling speakers. And he did that move where he's like, hey, man, come over here. And I was just the kind of person, I was like, all right. He said, come over there. I'll go over there. And I just walked over there, and he's like, you want some speakers? And I'm like, no, I mean, not really. I don't need them. And he's like, you need these speakers. And I said, well, I don't really have any money, but I was going to like deposit $80 in the bank or something. He's like, I'll take that money. You take the speakers. And I'm like, okay. So I took the two speakers. I never went to the bank. And I drove home. And when I got home, I took the two speakers out. They were giant speakers. And I said to Donnie, let's hook these bad boys up and let's test these speakers out. So, okay. middle of the week, middle of the day, plugged in the speakers in our very small apartment in North Hollywood. And he dropped in the CD, Van Halen, and went right to Eruption, because that's how we were going to test our speakers out. And I didn't even really know Eruption that well. I knew the Van Halen hits, but I didn't really know Eruption. And he then proceeded to turn it to 11 and just crank that thing. And he's like, you want to give these speakers a try? We're going to give them a try. And he just cranked Eruption all the way up. And at a certain point in the middle of Eruption, in the middle of the day, in the middle of the week, I couldn't hear somebody knocking, but I could feel it, like kunk, kunk, kunk. I could feel the concussion of somebody pounding on our front door. And I opened the front door, and it was our landlord, Jim. And Jim was standing there because we had bounced the rent check. And then Jim proceeded to look into our apartment because, you know, when you live in a little apartment, you open the front door, you can see everything. That's all there. We had the slot car track set up. We had rabbits running around. There was a bong in the infield of the slot car track. And it was the middle of the day. And it was the middle. And he, that's the only time he'd ever come to the unit. So in his world, he got out of the car and could hear Eruption coming down the street. Like, he parked on the street and could hear it down the street. And he had no context. He thought we sat around all day and just played Eruption as loud as we could. And once he stood at the door, he announced that he had that the last check had bounced, and he was thinking about evicting us. And I then wrote him another check. And I remember he got to that point. And I don't know if you guys have got to the point with your parents back in the day, or counselors or teachers, where they get beyond mad. They get into disgust, and they get into a sort of anguish, disgust, and
despair.
And despair. Like, he just kept going, I don't know. I just don't know. I just don't know what we're doing. Like, I don't know. Like, he wasn't even angry. He was just like, I don't know what to do with you guys. I don't know how to fix this, whatever you guys are. But I wrote him another check on the spot. He then drove straight to Home Savings and Loan, and that check bounced as well. And that's,
do you think he made that disgusted sound that you make? The bank.
Yeah. He was. Jim was Jim Posel was the guy's name. And I'd never forget that guy. And he went straight to the bank. I don't know if he bought another set of speakers, but he did bounce that check. And that was it. Eventually, we moved out about a year later. But it was Eruption that we were playing on. We were testing my new speakers out with.
It's a good way to christen new speakers. I don't know if Dawson's able to talk during this, but I assume that was important to him as a musician when he was learning. A lot of guitar players try and learn that song.
I was never even in the ballpark of having the chance of sitting next to someone who is that good.
It's that challenging to play.
So no?
Didn't even try.
No.
Yeah.
Adam, when I was a college student in the late 90s, there was still dudes selling speakers out of vans, which some of the guys, you know, friends of mine, people I knew, bought up. Like, how does this, I don't really call it a scam, because you get a speaker, albeit a low quality speaker, but how does this racket work? Why are there so many speakers being sold out of the backs of vans?
I imagine somebody works at a Kenwood stereo manufacturing plant in, you know, Inglewood, and works the graveyard shift and like pushes 10 out the door to their buddy in the van, and then the guy in the van shows up at the Home Saving and Loans parking lot. But I don't remember them being a brand on these things. I don't know if you off. I don't know that I don't, I cannot answer you that. All I can tell you is I was so dumb and so naive, and my self-esteem was so low that if someone's went, you want these speakers, right? I like didn't want to upset them. I was like, sure, I want those speakers. Okay. I didn't have any money. That was the last of the money I had, and it should have gone toward rent.
You were sucker grifted.
Sucker grift. What else we got, Teresa Strasser?
Well, speaking of grift, You don't hear about library grift very much, but there's a news story out of Austin, Texas today involving just that. You love a library, Adam, because
that's the
place.
That's my temple. That's where I go to unwind.
That's where they hide the books.
That's where they
There's
hide the books.
There's a guy named Randall White worked for the Austin Public Library. And over the course of 12 years, he stole at least $1.3 million worth of printer toner. Which is expensive. Between 2007 and 2019, he bought at least $1.5 million worth of toner for the library, which really only needed about $150,000 worth of toner. He'd then take most of the boxes of toner out with him. He told people he was taking them to other library branches, but he was really just taking them home to sell online. I guess he didn't have a van. Randall also used the library's credit cards to buy himself at least $18,000 worth of electronics, including video games, a drone, and a Roomba.
Can we do this? Could we do a 5-year plan to phase out the post office and public libraries and make all those facilities like vocational training facilities? Like, we will teach underprivileged kids a vocation at these facilities. We won't pull the plug on these places tomorrow, but 5 years from now, we will convert these places into a training facility for people that need, you know, lower income, whatever. Would you guys be down with that plan? Does anyone really need a library these days? And if not, wouldn't that same neighborhood benefit more from a like vocational training facility in that same neighborhood?
I don't know how much. I really don't know how much like libraries are utilized. It feels symbolically wrong to be closing libraries. I don't know. That's a little more feelings over facts. But I don't know. It feels wrong for our society symbolically to be closing these book warehouses and the places you can go to study or I don't know, whatever.
Well,
I spent a lot of time in our library in our community in Noe Valley, San Francisco, where I grew up, because nobody was home after school and I didn't have anywhere to go. But it was generally empty. Would that space be better utilized training kids, HVAC, plumbing, welding? I don't know.
Well, symbolically, but I mean, I'm not opening a strip club or a candle store. I would open vocational training in those places. And I would say, kind of the same with the post office. Like, I'll give you 5 years. Let's phase it out. I feel like there's no reason why we'll need it 5 years from now. They lose a lot of money. Let's put that money into training. Or we could make them, they could make them a youth center, you know, like a place where kids could go after school and do their studying or do whatever. But I just feel like there must be millions of square feet of public library and post offices strewn all around this country, many of which are in neighborhoods that aren't fantastic. What if we phased them out over the next decade, let's say, and started in on the training or the after school center or the youth center or the whatever that thing is? I think I would be down with that. Because books, almost like mail, like almost has to be going the way of the dodo, right? I don't know. I feel like if I walked
in. You just released a book.
Oh, God damn it. If I walked in, it's not a library. It's at an airport where the important people read books. If I walked into any given library, if you guys went to the closest library to where you live, and you walked in the door right now, who would you find in there? I guess that would be the question.
I'll actually prove your point even more. I couldn't reliably tell you where the nearest library is. I think I know, but I have not stepped foot in there.
I agree. All right, I agree with us. One more, Teresa Strasser, because Patty Smythe is on hold now waiting for us.
Halloween is just 24 days away, which seems hard to believe, especially if you haven't been outside since St. Patrick's Day. A new poll of 2,000 Americans has determined the most iconic Halloween movies. Do you want to hear the top five?
Can we guess?
Go ahead.
If it has the word Halloween in it, it shouldn't be on the
Halloween's
list, right?
A dead ringer, right, for top five.
Right.
That is the number one.
Yeah, all right. Is all the classic, the classics, Nightmare on Elm Street and
that's
and
number
Friday,
two.
Friday the 13th and all that shit.
That's number six. You're good at this.
Is Texas Chainsaw Massacre on there?
I'm sure that, yep, it's number 12.
All right.
I thought this was interesting. Scream. So they all screams there. They also polled the 2000 Americans for the creepiest theme song. And this theme song that I'm about to play you, you know how people have like a playlist, like athletes have a playlist before they have a big game.
Mm-hmm.
So this song voted the creepiest, was also Kobe Bryant's song to get himself pumped up. Let's take a listen. So here's what Kobe had to say. For certain key games, I don't think I've ever said this before. This kind of makes me seem kind of psychotic, but whatever. I used to play the Halloween theme song over and over in my headphones, seriously. And it was important that it was Michael Myers because the mask itself is void of emotion. It has nothing to do with pressure, nothing to do with hype, nothing to do with camaraderie. It's just stone cold killer. And I would listen to that song over and over and over to get, well, that's when you know you better run. It's going to be a tough night.
I do. It's sad but true that every single, I feel like one earmark of a great competitive athlete is to sort of decide that the world's against them and they need to attack. And these are not players on another team. They're foes. They're demons that are coming after them, mm-hmm. and they're going to have to slay them, you know. And for some reason, they just all have to put that into their own head. And without it, maybe Magic Johnson didn't have that. Maybe he had the theme from the Banana Splits playing in his head. Tra la 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 tra la 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 la. But so if I feel like that, I feel like Michael Jordan probably would have liked to hear the theme from what was it? Oh, Nightmare Halloween. At Halloween. Sorry on that as well. All right. Patty is waiting for us. So why don't we bring it home? Do we have a bring it home for Teresa Strasser?
Yeah, I'm Teresa Strasser. That's the news.
Teresa Strasser and the news. Fuck you, CNN.